Hello everybody, so let's begin with our another weekly session. Today's session we'll be covering about the logging methods in Python. So for logging, people usually do print methods, but print method is usually not the preferred way of doing if you're dealing with scripts. So if it's a big project, has multiple modules and sub packages, so logging is not the best way to deal with it. The print method is not the best way to deal with it. We have a separate package which is known as logging. So logging does all the stuff required for debugging, information storing and all that. And if you want, you can the script can store that in a separate txt file for every run. That is logging. Then we'll cover a bit introductory aspect of unit testing. Why is it important? How does it help? And understanding basic unit tests, not at a very deep level, because unit testing is a great topic in itself, so it would take a lot of time. And finally, we'll wrap up with another topic, which is the last and final topic, would be understanding pandas, get dummies and OneHotEncoding methods. Although, why this topic out of sudden or out of the blue? But this is an interesting topic and many people confuse and get confused about what exactly this is. So why not discuss it? All right, stay tuned. Hello, hi, so let's begin. And before we begin, another great announcement which I have to make. So I've configured my Linux system and sooner or later, just I need to get started with how the OBS recording system works. So I'm pretty new to it. I've never ever worked on OBS system, recording system. So once I figure it out, I'll be posting videos for Linux users or Linux viewers as well. So how to get the system set up for Anaconda or Docker installation, all those kind of things. So stay tuned. Pretty soon it would be up. Till then, let's get started with logging. So what is logging? And we'll be covering with the official documents. And this is something pretty much useful if you are a hardcore software developer or if your code is kind of pretty big. So if you're running a single script, then you need not to learn or invest time on how this logging or other things work. But if your work deals with, let's say I have done multiple projects wherein I have a folder, the folder has subfolders, within the subfolders you have multiple scripts. So it's extremely difficult to keep a track with the help of print statement, and that is not even recommended. So print statement is beneficial if the code will execute within 5 to 10 minutes. At max. So if you expect your code's execution to end up in 5 to 10 minutes, then print statement is the best way to go as an instant output mechanism. But if it's not an instant output mechanism, then what you should do is you should have a locking system so that once your execution is completed, all the logs would be stored and a log file would be generated. Whether it's a success or whether it's a failure, whatever it is, whatever the case might be, you'll have a log file generated for your experimentation or the run, whatever you did, right? So that's where logging is useful. That's a very superficial understanding. I think you have got the hang of it. So what it does is runs your script. You can have a terminal or the console output as well, but people, the best way to utilize logging. So we are not trying to understand this the similarity or commonality between logging and printing. We are trying to differentiate between logging and printing. And the difference is printing is and should be used whenever you are expecting the output to be seen within 5 to 10 minutes or at a constant interval or the best way is till the time you are sitting right in front of the screen. If you are not sitting right in front of the screen, the best way to do is use logging. Logging will generate a script and the outputs of whatever the events happened. So logging is for event happenings or whatever happened with your system or whatever happened with that particular code lines, code cells or the modules during that span of time, and that's it. So this is a very pretty interesting table which is provided by the Python documentation, official Python documentation. So what is it? So if you want to display the console output for an ordinary usage, mind the word ordinary usage, then you should use print. If not, you want to report the normal operation, let's say status monitoring or fault investigation, whatever happened during the operation of a program, then you should go via logging. If you want to issue a warning for a particular runtime, let's say warning would be something like you plan to warnings, which are usually I've seen warning are the depreciation warnings. So you are using a particular Python package, you will or must have seen a lot of depreciation warnings. What are these? These are like, this will be supported till this version only. After that, the support would be removed. So it's trying to tell you and make you familiar with, let's say sklearn or any TensorFlow has a utility, you're using this. So before sklearn model selection, there was something else. So it changed, but before whatever it was, during the transition time, there's a warning message displayed, which helps you to get accustomed to the changes. This is the industry standard. What could be your use case for warning would be something else. It would be like, okay, like you might have not explicitly defined a integer or input type. You might run into an error. Are you comfortable with this? So this might be a custom warning. So whatever it is, depending upon your use case, your understanding, your requirement, right? Now you have a report and error regarding a particular runtime event. So if you have to report an error of a particular runtime event, then definitely raise an exception. If you don't want to raise an exception, you can log the errors. Now, there are different types of logging methods. One is debug. The other is info and warning, which are most widely used. Then we have error and critical. So let's get started and we'll get more familiar with what exactly these are. So the first example is this, import logging, logging.warning and logging.info. I hope you are able to see my screen. So why this one prints, however this one didn't print. Good enough. Print it out on the console. Info message does not appear because the default level is warning. The printed message includes the indication of the level and the description of the event provided in the logging call. Don't worry about the root part for now. It will be explained later. The actual output can be formatted quite flexibly if you need that. So we have this. There's something like default levels. The default level is stored as warning. You can store the default level as info as well. And as it is the default level, the message for this default level got printed out. Now, if you want to save, the ultimate purpose of logging is saving it to somewhere else. So let's say I want to store the outputs at a different place, and the different place would be So if you try to understand this particular piece of code, it says that logging.debug, this should go to the log file, so this should show this and this too, right? And let's say I don't see the file. So, hi, let's start with logging. First, we're going to start with main script. And let's get the first part done. Just this part, right? So in logging, as you can see, the first example which we saw was this logging dot warning, and you can add any warning message that say, hey, it's let's say, hey, the version, the upcoming versions will have a significant changes, plan accordingly. Whereas the nature of the info messages, you can put everything under info, but you should know which one to use when, right? So that would be a more systematic approach to your work. So info method would be successful code run. And if you run this, this is a warning which is highlighted in the red, and you didn't print the info method. Now let's say I want to do some changes. So logging dot basic configuration, let's say file name would be logging dot log, and then we have the debugging level. So level would be equal to logging dot debug. Now you have five different levels right over here. Debug, info, warning. We have error, we have critical. So by default, this is the default level. Anything beyond this is printed, not anything above it. Now if you set info as default level, then info and beyond would be printed, not the debug. If you set debug as the default level, everything would be printed. So this time we should expect everything to be printed. Yep, everything got printed and got stored in a file. If you don't add a file name, then let's see what happens. Then everything gets printed in the console. So the preferred method is have a logging file and get the output over there. So this is the basic introduction. Now let's move on to a bit complex level, which is, let's say you have multiple files, which is my app, my lib. How are you going to deal with it? So let's make a new file, my app. Mylib. What is this particular file doing? This is first getting the logging and getting the imports from mylib. So I would assume mylib is the primary part. So within mylib, you're getting the logging part, import logging, and def function one. What the function one does is it logs the info, logging dot info, that is under func one in mylib. Whereas in my app, what I can do, which is the main script, I would ask the main to run, whereas my main would be. So this is one style of writing wherein you have a main defined in the function, a bit out of context. So what people usually do is deliver this and write the main code over here. But some people write a way more cleaner code style of writing, and that is this: define the main as a different function, which we usually do in C++ or Java. So let's say basic configuration is this time, let's have the logging level as info level. Anything from info and beyond would be printed, but not debug. And logging dot info, let's say starting. Very makes sense, right? You would like to point out, when did you start? That is an information, that is not a warning, that is an information. Now let's say mylib dot function one, you called it, and now you want to print the successful completion of your work. All of this would be stored . So this is your logging file which has been generated. Now that is the main use case. If you have multiple files and this is only a single folder with some 3 or 4 files, what you usually have is a single folder which has multiple subfolders. Subfolders might have subfolders and then you have multiple files. If you work on an actual project level thing all on your own, or let it be even in a team, so you would need logging, which is a better way to deal with things like these. Now if you want to store out variable data, then what would you do? Usually warning would be something like, let's say a equals to 10, and if a is greater than 5, logging.info rather logging.error invalid value entered, and you can add the values a equal to a must be less than equal to 5. And over here what you can do is else call the my function, and let's say how it goes. So one problem is it overwrote the previous configuration file. How do you get over this? Those are advanced topics, let it be. Let's not get into it, might get confused. So this is something we covered, changing the format of the displayed method. Yeah, this is the format. Usually the format is, at this point of time, is the root is getting printed, which we don't want. So what you can define over here in the basic configuration is a format as well. And the format can be percentage this thing, then percentage another thing is, so first thing which you would like to have is the level name. Next thing which you would like to have is message. Sometimes you might want to have the time, which is usually the case of model training or data science. So what you'd like to do is something like this, when run, would give an output like this without the root thing. Now I don't want this entire thing. What I want is the date in a better format and the time in a better format. 056, I don't know what exactly it is. So let's get the date format. The time. Day, month, and then we have year. Hour and minutes are fine. And good enough. So you can see much cleaner, much better, and good. So if you add that P parameter, it would print out AM, PM, so as to have better understanding. And I think this is way better and way clearer than what we were doing previously. Now we have got a bit understanding of logging. This is another thing. One is a cookbook. The other is advanced logging tutorial, which we might not take at this point. However, it's quite interesting. It would be better if you get started at your own and let me know where did this go for you. But what happens if no configuration is provided? Let it be. Now let's see if we have something to add from this blog post. This blog post talks about logging. Logging, formatting the output, the logging basic configurations. We did see the basic configurations, the level, file name, file mode, which default is append. So let's say, I think this should suffice with a lot of your basic experimentation. As you're not a software developer, you're a data scientist. So it's data science is usually a blend between software development, mathematics, statistics, and a lot many fields, and that makes a data scientist, that gives rise and birth to a data scientist. So it's good to learn different tools, but don't jump extremely, don't get absorbed by it. That's what I've always, or that's a word of caution that I always put forward in front of my viewers. Don't get absorbed by anything that is taking, I mean, do get absorbed, but please try to understand to what extent you need to understand and get into a concept. That is, I think, the primary concern at this point of time. File mode should be write mode, and I think it would no more overwrite. And yep, it is no more overwriting and making a new file. Well, you can log the variable data as well. Let's say we just logged the variable data, so that is fine. We did this part, capturing stack traces. So this is pretty interesting. Let's try it out. Let me comment out this part. And let's try out this piece of code. What is it? It talks about A equals to 5, B equal to 6. Then we have try c equal to a by b except exception as e, and then you have logging dot error, which is nothing but the exception raised, and execution info equal to true. This would help you trace out what went wrong. nothing went wrong, let's make it go wrong, and thereby we see the logging. So this is an error part exception handling. So if you add logging.exception rather than logging.error, what would it do? So if you know that an error or exception is to be there, rather than having error, it's better to have exception. Reason being, it is dealt in a better manner. Show log at the level of error. If you don't want that, you can call any of the logging methods from debug to critical and pass execution info as true. Well, we can have classes for logging as well. We can have handlers. If you are dealing with file over the internet, receiving and sending files, then also you need to have a logging system. Other configuration systems are having a dictionary method, those kind of things, configuration files. So these are the things where you actually need logging, and I think we did a good brief introduction of what logging is. Although the topic we have covered is quite superficial, there exists a deeper part and a greater part to it, which is understanding how to do logging and how to do advanced level of logging with classes for multiple files, modules, and those kind of things. But I think this does give you a brief and good overview of what logging is. So without any wasting time, let's start with unit test in Python. Now what unit test is? So how do you test out your code? You will make a script, let's say this is a script, you will pass in some values, a equal to 10, b equal to 5, and that's how you test it. But you know that you are in a constant improvement of the code, and it's not pretty comfortable to every time pass, let's say, this is your code running, and you say python 3 main.py, and you execute the command, which requires several parameters which need to be passed to the argument parser. In such a scenario, it would be a sheer wastage of time to pass the arguments each and every time. What do? You make test scripts as well. So those are the scripts which you know that these are the normal cases, these are the edge cases, and these need to be passed in order to validate the code and its productivity. What do to save time? It's a one-time investment, just like logging. It's a one-time investment by making a test script which will generate out the report of how the test performed in the how did the algorithm perform for the test. So let's begin. Hi, so let's resume with the next topic of discussion, which is unit testing. Why unit testing? So it's an interesting topic. So after logging, the next topic, which should be quite pretty obvious to you, would be how to perform unit testing. Now, what is the difference between normal testing and unit testing? In normal testing or integration testing, your entire application is tested and its workflow is tested out. But you are just working on a specific component, and you want within a specific component you're interested over a specific utility or a function. You would not be running full testing, as that would be a sheer wastage of time. Rather, you would be designing out tests which are specific to that particular component. So if you're into something which is for testing out specific components, and that is known as unit testing. Now within unit testing, we have several different methodologies. First is you need to have unit test imported. Within unit test, let's say a class. Within a class, you can have several functions, and you can run the unit test method over here. But let's see how it happens over here. Better visualization would be a very naive implementation would be, let's say you define test case one, then you define another test case. Yes, that can be done, but it's not scalable and it's not maintainable or it's not organizable. So what we do is make it scalable and maintainable and organizable. To do that, we import unit test and a Python class wherein it is inheriting unit test.test case. Within this, every function should have a prefix of test underscore and whatever the function name is. So let's say I'm working on a function which is to assert that the sum is 6 or not. Assert equal. So at the present moment, we are not passing any arguments, but you can pass in the list arguments. Let's say list sum, and over here you can say any value, let's say 6. Yeah, and if not, then pass in the error message. It should be equal to 6, right? But no, let's not jump into such detailed complexities. Let's just attribute start would be better. Testing started. I think we had an error. Test failed. Why? 2 plus 3 is 5, and this is another thing which is 6. These are not equal, but what if I add some parameter to this? Now this should pass successfully, right? Finished. Test case passed 1, good enough. So that's the difference. And so let's make another test case and make it deliberately fail, so as to understand what's the difference exactly is. So let's say test sum tuple, and over here it would be a tuple, and the tuple is something like this. Let's change the value to 4 and let's run it. One failed, one warning, and I think one executed perfectly. Which one failed? This particular one failed. Test sum tuple failed. Should be equal to 6. 6 is not equal to 7. The output is 7 over here. And good enough. So let's jump into more detailed execution. So let's do this project style, which is actually the industry standard and where you would be using it the most. So let's say a new folder would be sum. Within sum, I have init. Which says definition sum, pass the arguments. You pass the sum, pass the add up all the values and return the added result. Now to test it out, we'll be defining a separate Python code file, which would be testing.py. Within test.py, you'll have everything defined. So import unit test, also import the file. So from sum import sum, and let's say class test sum. So how does it help? So for particular, you will have a single test file, and for each subdirectory you can have a different class which will handle each subdirectory and can be scaled up to whatever the requirements are or can be in the future. So over here you pass in the normal inheritance, this dot test case, def test list integer. This is quite pretty interesting. What does it do? So data equals to 1, 2, 3, result equal to sum data, self dot assert equal result, and 6. I think pretty much that's what it is. If name equals equals main, and run the unit test. That's it. I don't think this anything huge or anything complicated over here. The only thing you need to learn about this is their utility, and utility is the main beauty. Once you understand the utility of logging or unit testing, things will be making much more sense to you than they are making at this point. So we have just utilized and explored assert equal. There are multiple methods. Assert equal true can be done for boolean checking, is can be done for type checking, is none has its own instance, sorry, is instance can be done for type checking, is can be done for whether variables are equal or not. Executioning your first test. I think we did cover this particular article. Let's move on to something more interesting. Something like let's check the official documentation. I am nothing better than that. Official documentation is the ultimate resource to learn many things. And what is PyTest? PyTest and unit test are two different things, but if you learn about unit test, PyTest would be is quite similar to unit test. So let's execute PyTest over here. Where is it? PyTest. And good enough. Just check the version 6.2.3, quite updated. That's what I would say. And so this is one example, first test case. For PyTest and unit test are a bit different. PyTest is the advanced version which is built on top of unit test, and unit test has this pattern, so does PyTest has this pattern. There's a slight difference in between unit test and PyTest, and I think we did an introductory part for unit test. We can switch to PyTest. I think we did not cover this part. @method skip. So if you are doing this, let's say skip class test case. So these are some utilities. So if you want to skip particular test cases in a Go, so you know that these are the test cases which won't be passed. So you can add the attribute over at the top, like @ unit test dot skip, and skipping this test case, and you'll be good to go. All right, so there are multiple methods: simple skip, skip if, skip unless, and. Well, I think we did cover a lot. This is good enough. Just take your time, explore PyTest. PyTest is pretty much similar to this unit testing, and this is a method, I mean, pretty much similar. So let's search difference between unit test and PyTest. PyTest has rich inbuilt features which require less piece of code compared to unit test. Yeah, absolutely. So basically PyTest is built on top of unit test, and if you're using PyTest it will be much easier. But if it's not, unit test isn't even hard or difficult to understand. Once you understand unit test well, it would be extremely easy to migrate to PyTest. So unit test has a bit Pythonic approach, whereas PyTest is all about functions. Define functions. Although you can have a class, that also works. Output is bit more organized, bit better, easily understandable. That is the difference between unit test and PyTest. You can learn about PyTest at your own end. Now let us move on to the last topic of the day, which is OneHotEncoder. And get dummies, OneHotEncoder versus get dummies. I might have written an article on this. Let me check. Is there a method to search the discussions? Topics. So a topic would be up over here, which would be quite descriptive. In the meanwhile, what we can do is discuss about what is OneHotEncoder, what is Pd.getdummies, dummy encoding, and why do we use or prefer OneHotEncoder. So Pd.getdummies returns a panda data frame, but let me show any images or not. So this is what your target data encoded variable is. So you have call me yes, no, maybe. So there are three options, 0, 1, 2. So what would be call me dash maybe? This is a variable. So for this particular column, which is maybe, we have 1 over here and rest of the value 0. So is the case for no, we have value 1 over here, rest of the value 0, and so is the case for yes. We have three values as yes and two values as no. Then you can transform this for the test data set as well. Apply the same transformation. Now what is the difference between dummy encoding and OneHotEncoder? dummy encoding is a feature which is provided by pandas itself. So it does the maintain the understandability and the inferencing for you. But people usually prefer OneHotEncoding, and why is so? The reason being, you have encoder, OneHotEncoder, panda encoded equal to data.frame, encoder.fit_transform, this particular thing, and then you have the column.encoder.get the feature names. So this and this is quite same, but you need to code a bit. Usually people prefer this OneHotEncoding bit because it has the ability to handle the values which were not seen. So usually prefer this. Let's see over there what exactly it is. So for machine learning, you will definitely want to use OneHotEncoding, as I said. For other tasks like simple analysis, panda.getdummies can be done. And there's one particular library you can, or you can even design on your own. So you can make a blend of the features like return a pandas data frame, which does not happen in OneHotEncoding. So you can write and extend a code which inherits the OneHotEncoding. Within the fit transform, you return a pandas frame data frame. So that would solve the purpose or the utility which is solved by pandas.getdummies. Else OneHotEncoding is the safest way. Why? Because persistent and can be applied to new data sets which use the same categorical variable with consistent results. This is what it is. Persistency is there with OneHotEncoding, which is not the case with panda.getdummies. And that is why we prefer OneHotEncoding over panda.getdummies. So let us understand this whole article. What it says, like, note that how we apply the same encoder we created via X-train to the new dataset X-test. What happens if X-test contains new different levels than X-train for one of its variables? Let's say for color contains only red and green, but in addition to those, we have a blue. We'll end up with a traditional color blue column, which X-train does not have. And the inconsistency will probably break our code later on, especially if we are feeding the X-test to an xklearn model, because you'll have different number of columns, right? So for training, you will have two different columns, color red, color green, whereas for testing, you will have color red, color green, color blue, and that would end up as an error. So this is the only test case. If there's a categorical variable, if the number of types of categorical variables which are not there, which are not same for the training and testing data, then panda.getdummies might break, and that is why it is always safe to use OneHotEncoding. OneHotEncoder, on the other hand, we can reuse it to produce the same output every time with columns red and green, and we can explicitly control what happens when it encounters a new level. Either you can say error or you can deal it with ignore, depending upon the use case. If the instances are very low, you can ignore. If the instances are pretty high, then there might be some reasoning logic behind it, and we can get into the reasoning and logic. I think this is it. Else the output is quite similar. This OneHotEncoding does the array output. Panda.getdummies does the data frame output. So this was one project I remember somebody did, was to inherit the OneHotEncoding and return the result in a proper data frame. I think that is something you can do as a task, takeaway task, take home task. Alright, I hope this session was useful. If it was, please ensure you do hit the subscribe button. Alright, take care, bye.